बिस्मिल्लाहिर्रहमानिर्रहीम, अल्हम्दुलिल्लाह, सलातु सलाम अला रसूलिल्लाहिल करीम। अस्सलामु अलैकुम व रहमतुल्लाह व बरकातुहु। डियर ग्रुप मेंबर्स, दिस इज माय सिक्स्थ लेक्चर इन दिस सीरीज ऑफ in the series of lectures on the Karbala, the real incidents of the Karbala that happened on 10th of Muharram. So to begin with, yesterday we saw how Sayyidina Ammar ibn Yasir was martyred in Jang-e-Siffin, and now I'll bring to you an incident where one of a very prominent sahabi of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who was very much active politically during his stay, during his life in Makkah, and when Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam Medina, and even after that, and even after the demise of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, till he died as he was the military commander, or rather the chief commander of Muawiyah bin Abi Sufyan. So this sahabi is none other than Sayyidina Amr ibn al-As radiyallahu anhu. So this hadith is about the time of death of Sayyidina Amr ibn al-As radiyallahu anhu, and this is present in Sahih Muslim, hadith 321, Musnad Ahmad 17815 and 17816. It is a very long hadith, hadith number 6929. Sheikh Shuaib al-Arnaut, the Grand Mufti of Qatar, has said that the chain of this hadith is authentic. So to bring with this hadith portrays the time of the death of Amr ibn al-As. When he was on the deathbed, he called up his sons and he then gave the piece of advice, or rather the piece of his mind, to his sons on his deathbed, and he recalled whatever he did throughout his life. So to start with, Sayyidina Ibn Shumasha rahmatullah alayh narrates that we came to Amr ibn al-As radiyallahu anhu when he was about to die. He wept for a long time and turned his face towards the wall. As it is very obvious that when men do cry, but when they cry a lot, they feel ashamed and then they turn towards the wall so that nobody sees them, an unabashed situation. So watching his father cry, his son said, "O my father, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam has given you the great tidings of such and such, had given you the good news of such and such." Amr ibn al-As turned to face us and said, "The best that we companions would count was on the testimony that none has the right to be worshipped but Allah, and the Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the Messenger of Allah sallallahu Messenger of Allah. This is more than the glad tidings. Believing in Allah and His Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the greatest thing that one can ever do." He further says, "O my son, I went through three phases of my life. In the first phase, in the days of ignorance, no one was more hated to me than Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And there was nothing I wanted more than to overpower him and kill him. Nauzu billah min zalik." Because as you know that Amr ibn al-As was the man, he was the think tank of the Quraysh of Makkah, and therefore he was very educated and he was very intelligent and very eloquent. So this is why whenever there used to be some arbitration with the people of the other clans and other tribes, then this was the man. He was sort of a foreign minister to the Quraysh of Makkah. So he was the man who used to go there and talk to people. And that is why the Quraysh of Makkah has sent him to the Najashi, or rather in English you can call Negus of Ethiopia, the king of Ethiopia. The Negus is the title of the king of Ethiopia. So he went there to persuade him to let the Muslims return back to Makkah with him forcibly, so that they can torture them. And you know what happened in the court of Negus, where Sayyidina Abbas ibn al-Muttalib, the elder brother of Hazrat Ali, he told everybody, Negus, he recited the Surah Maryam, and this caused a effect on Negus, and he told them to continue with the stay in Ethiopia, and he refused him, and he refused Amr ibn al-As' presence and told him to go away. So he was the foreign minister, sort of the main think tank of the Quraysh of Makkah. He further says that if I had died at that phase, surely, no doubt. But another phase of my life came when Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam put the love of Islam in my heart. I came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, said, hold out your right hand so that I may swear Islam in my heart. I might swear allegiance to you. So he held out his right hand. But, oh Amr, what is the matter? He sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, when he was going to take the bayah to show his allegiance to Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he held back his hand, and sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that, why are you doing? You are taking your hand back. So Amr ibn al-As said that I want to stipulate a condition before accepting Islam. He sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, what do you want to stipulate? I said that I will be forgiven for my previous sins, because he was very much concerned about his previous sins, because they were so grave nature. So he was very much concerned about his previous sins, what he has done. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, do you not though know that accepting Islam destroys all the previous sins, and that Hajj also destroys all the previous sins? So Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam reiterated that if you accept Islam, if a non-Muslim accepts Islam, his all the previous sins are erased, while his good deeds stay that way. And if you do a Mabrur Hajj, the accepted Hajj, then all your sins are erased. So when I accepted Islam, then no one was more beloved to me than him, that is Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and no one was dearer in my eyes than him sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I could never look him in the eye because of awe. Because sometimes what happens that if you love somebody, have the courage to meet your eyes with him or her. And since being a Sahabi and being a Muslim, Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the most dearest to him. So he was unable to meet him in his eyes. He was unable to see him because of that aura that Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had. And my condition was such that if I were to be asked to describe, rightly so, if you are not seeing anybody with your full eyes, with your full gaze, then you will not be able to describe the features of that person. Because I could never look him in the eye. If I had died in that phase, that is the second phase of his life, I hope that I would have been one of the people of paradise. Rightly so. Then came the third phase of my life, when we were appointed to positions regarding the rule in which I do not know what my status is, right or wrong. And this was the period when, during the Khilafat of Ali alayhi salam, he sided with Muawiyah ibn Abi Sufyan and he rebelled against the righteously guided Caliph Amirul Mumineen Sayyidina Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salam. Now if I die, do not let any wearing woman or fire as a custom accompany my funeral. So it is haram for a Muslim to have people who are doing noha following the funeral procession and to take the fire. You cannot take fire or the mourning procession along with the funeral of a Muslim. So he told to his son, when you bury me, sprinkle water as per sunnah at my graveyard. It is a sunnah to sprinkle the water on the grave of a dead person. Buried person, and stay on my grave for the length of time it takes to slaughter a camel and distribute its meat. That is, it takes around 2.5 hours to slaughter a camel, to cut the carcass, make it into small pieces and distribute. So it takes around 2.5 hours. So that I may be comforted at my graveyard by your presence and answer the messengers of my Lord, the angels. That is, I may persistently answer the questions of the graveyard. So it is highly recommended that every Muslim, if somebody dies from his home, then he should stay at the grave for some time. Here Amr ibn al-As radiallahu anhu is saying 2.5 hours. So that the person in the grave would be comforted that his family side. And the other wordings of Musnad Ahmad of this same hadith is that when Amr ibn al-As was about to die, he started to weep. His son Sayyidina Abdullah bin Amr ibn al-As, he is one of the four famous Abdullahs in the Islamic history, asked, are you weeping for the fear of Allah? He said, no, by Allah, I fear from stages coming after the death. The son said, you radiallahu anhu remained focused on the good of Islam in the entire life, and you were also blessed with the company of Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and you also participated in the victories of Sham. Yes, no doubt, he is the man who was in, he was a man who was surrounded by the Roman Emperor and they were going to decimate him when just on the moment he was with Abu Ubaida ibn al-Jarrah radiallahu anhu, and just in the moment Khalid bin Walid radiallahu anhu appeared from nowhere from Iraq, and he is the man who was in the Battle of Yarmouk, one of the commanders of the Muslim army. So this is what his son was saying, that you have been with Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and even best of the battles, and you have conquered Sham, that is the Syria and the Levant. And to add to it, I just want to say that this is the man who was victorious over Egypt for three times. थ्री टाइम्स ही वन इजिप्ट फॉर द मुस्लिम्स, थ्री टाइम्स इट स्लिप्ड ऑफ द हैंड्स ऑफ द मुस्लिम्स एंड थ्री टाइम्स ही वन. वेन एवर देर यूज टू बी अ फायर फाइटिंग इशू देन ही वॉज सेंट. ही वॉज सेंट थ्राइस, वंस बाई उमर इब्न अल खत्ताब रदी अल्लाह अनु एंड ट्वाइस बाई उस्मान इब्न अल अफ़ान रदी अल्लाह अनु. सो ही कॉन्कर्ड इजिप्ट थ्राइस. अम्र इब्न अल आस देन सेड ही डीड बेटर देन दीज गुडनेस and that is to testify there is no god except Allah and that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the messenger of Allah. So he said that jihad is of not that nature of that virtue, the virtue which is to proclaim shahada. To proclaim shahada is the biggest virtue a person can have in his life. I have passed through three phases and I know very well about my condition in every phase. He knew that he was wrong in the first phase, then he was very good in the second phase, and then he was skeptical about the third phase. I was a believer in the beginning, in the first phase, and was the enemy of Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam more than others. Had I died in that state, I would have definitely been in fire. Then in the second phase, when I pledged allegiance to him on Islam, I would respect him more than others. So much so that I never saw him in the eye due to his respect, nor I discussed any issue with him until he died. Had I died at that time, in that phase, and now he just imagine the Sahabi of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is saying that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam died. So I just want to make out this is the language, not my language, or not a language of a Wahhabi, but this is the language of a Sahabi or Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that he's saying that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam died. Had the Prophet, the people would say congratulations to Umar. He accepted Islam and remained focused on good and then died. So we hope that he will enter the paradise. Everybody would have said that. After that, I reached to the monarchy of Muawiyah bin Abu Sufyan. What he was saying, monarchy. He was not saying caliphate. He was not a caliph. He was a monarch of the Muslims. That I reached to the monarchy of Muawiyah radiallahu anhu in my third phase and did such acts, that is going out against the righteous caliph Sayyidina Ali ibn Abi Talib, that I do not know whether they are right or wrong. Now that I am going to die, no mourner or fire should accompany my bier as a ritual and tie my apron well, because there will be quarrel with me, and throw the earth gently over me, because my right side, that is of the goodness, does not deserve more earth than my left side. So he said that he thinks that he has done, if he has done something good, then he has also done something bad, and both these things do not outweigh each other. Don't place wood or a stone on my grave. So Muslims, just learn from this Sahabi of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that what you should not do on a grave while burying your dead. Don't place wood or a stone on my grave, and you have buried me, stand over my grave for the space of time within which a camel is slaughtered and its mate is distributed, so that I may feel comfort from your presence at my grave. Because as you know, there is a Sahih Hadith of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that the dead person hears his relatives going away. So if they do not go away, so he might think that they are there atop my grave, and he would be comfortable lying in his grave alone. So very mind-blowing, and so very, you cannot describe this feeling, a person dying and saying all these things. The wordings of Anand said is that Sayyidna Abu Nawfal rahmatullah alayh narrates that Amr ibn al-As radiyallahu anhu started intense crying at the time of death. His son Sayyidna Abdullah bin Amr bin As asked, "Oh Abu Abdullah, why are you making noise and crying? While the Messenger of Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam kept you close and he would assign you special responsibilities." Amr ibn al-As said, "Yes, my son, this was, but I shall tell you the main thing of my heart. By Allah, I did not know why he treated me well. Due to love or for my satisfaction. So, as you very well know that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was so courteous to his companions and to other people that everybody used to think that Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam loved me the most. Everybody used to think that. Because he was so courteous, he was so down to earth and he was so loving to people that everybody thought that he was the most loving to me. He loved me the most. Every Sahabi had that feeling." So this is what Amr ibn al-As said, that I do not know whether he was doing it of his intrinsic quality of loving everybody or whether I was really good. But let me testify and tell you the two lucky person whom Allah's Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam has been pleased with till his death. Now he said that he told his son that I do not know whether Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was really happy with me, but I do know the names of two people with whom Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was happy, was pleased till the time of his death. And who were these two? First of them was the son of Sayyida Sumayya alayhi salam radiyallahu anha. So this is the answer to the question which I asked yesterday, which nobody answered. Unfortunately, they might not have seen this video. So she was Sayyida Sumayya and she was the freed slave of Abu Jahl, and she was the mother of Ammar ibn Yasir and wife of Sayyidina Yasir alayhi salam, and these two couple were the first martyrs of Islam. They were martyred in Makkah Sharif and died while being tortured. When due to torture, Sayyidina Yasir died, and when Sayyida Sumayya cursed Abu Jahl, then he introduced that spear into her private parts. It is disgusting to think about such a situation when Muslims were being tortured and they were in a very bad condition. So Sayyida Sumayya, the mother of Ammar ibn Yasir. So Amr ibn al-As is saying that first of them was the son of Sayyida Sumayya radiyallahu anhu anha, that is Sayyidina Ammar ibn Yasir, and the second was the son of Sayyida Abad, that is Sayyidina Abdullah bin Masood, the shepherd Sahabi, the most, one of the most poor Sahabi, whom Abu Jahl had beaten up in the premises of Kaabatullah when he recited the few verses of Quran Majid openly in the compound in the Mataf area of Kaaba Sharif. He was beaten ruthlessly by Abu Jahl, but Allah in the Battle of Badr, he was given the opportunity of cutting the neck of Abu Jahl. And he was such a learned person that Prophet ﷺ said that he was one of the four people who was told that if you want to learn Quran, then learn from Sayyidina Abdullah bin Masood. And he was appointed the Grand Mufti of Kufa by all Sayyidina Abu Bakr, by Sayyidina Umar, Sayyidina Osman, and Sayyidina Ali. All the four Khalifa Rashid appointed him to be the Grand Mufti of Kufa, or rather the Persia whole. When Ammar ibn Yasir, Amr ibn al-As completed his talk, he put his hand under his chin and said, "O Allah, what you ordered us, we abandoned it. That is your order." Now he is repenting to Allah that what you ordered it, we abandoned it, your order, and you told us not to do some acts, but we did. Now there is no way except for forgiveness. Sayyidina Abdullah bin Amr bin As narrates, Amr bin Al-As kept on repeating this prayer till he died after some time. So such is the death of such glorious people whom Allah gives time for repentance so that they can repent. So always pray to Allah and make dua that He should save you from a sudden death. There won't be any time to ask for repentance. So always pray to Allah that you don't die suddenly, but there should always be a time where that thing of repentance comes onto your tongue and into your heart, and you seek proper repentance from Allah. And I'm saying you, for what I'm saying it to you, that applies me to me first. Whatever I'm telling you, I'm not telling it to you, but I'm telling it to myself, because I think that I am the most deserving person to have the hidayah from Allah. So coming on to this, the another wording of this hadith, I'm telling you all the wordings because this is a very, very big hadith, and this is a very important hadith. So every Muslim should know about it. The word of another hadith of Musnad Ahmad is said that Sayyidina Khalid radiallahu anhu, that I was with Muawiyah bin Abi Sufyan, and suddenly two men came to me quarreling with the head of Sayyidina Ammar ibn al-Yasir alayhi salam, wallahu alam. Na'udhu billahi min zalik. They were both quarreling for the head of Sayyidina Ammar. Both were claiming to have killed him. Na'udhu billahi min zalik. This means that they were claiming themselves to be in the hellfire. May Allah protect us from this ignorance, from the guna, from the kufr, from the shirk, from the bidah, from the bad deeds. Both were claiming to have killed Sayyidina Ammar ibn Yasir, na'udhu billahi min zalik. And after seeing this scene, Sayyidina Abdullah bin Amr bin Al-As, the son of Amr ibn Al-As, said, "You should leave it That is the claim of killing to your companion instead of being proud of this killing. Because the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, a rebellious group will kill Sayyidina Ammar. Hearing this, Muawiyah bin Abi Sufyan said to Amr ibn al-As, bin Amr bin As, because he has told already, Amr ibn al-As has told already all the hadith that the rebellious group will kill Sayyidina Ammar, and he told that you just drown in your own urine. And he then said that Sayyidina Ali brought him to us so that he could be killed, and that might prove and that might look like that Sayyidina Ali is on that right path. So now his son Sayyidina Amr ibn al-As then said the same thing, that the person who will kill him will be in the hellfire. So on hearing this, Muawiyah bin Abi Sufyan got angry. No doubt, if you are in a wrong path and you are leading a battle and you are now told in the middle of the battle that you are on the wrong path, then it is very difficult to accept that truth. Because had he accepted that truth, he would not have rebelled against the rightly guided caliph. So he got very egged, very cheesed off. And so he said to his friend, to his cousin, Amr ibn al-As, O Amr, rid us of your crazy son. And O Abdullah, if it is like that, then why are you with us? He said that get rid of this fellow, of my nephew, because he was his nephew, he was cousin and he was a nephew, and he was telling it to his chacha. And so he said that if you am so bad, then why are you with me? Why don't you get rid of us and leave us? Get lost. That is, get out of my group. Sayyidina Abdullah bin Amr ibn al-As replied to Muawiyah bin Abi Sufyan, my father once complained about me to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, so he ordered me to obey my father as long he is alive and not to disobey him. So I, that is taking into consideration this advice of him, will be present with you, but I will not take part in the fight against the right caliph Sayyidina Ali. So he was a real mujahid, the real companion of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the harbinger of truth, and he told in the mouth of his uncle Muawiyah, and he said that I am with my father not because I am supporting you, I am with my father because my father once has complained to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam about my mischiefs, and no doubt, and Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told him that never leave your father. And this is the hikmah. This is the real hikmah that Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told him to be with his father so that he can give him the right advice. And this is what he said, that I am with you because I was commanded by Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but I will never take to fighting along with you because Sayyidina Ali is on the right path. He told in the face of Muawiyah ibn Abi Sufyan. So such are the companions of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Even if they do something wrong out of their ignorance, because no doubt they are men, they are human beings, they can make mistakes, but as Allah has said that I like people who seek repentance from me and I forgive them. So Amr ibn al-As radiallahu anhu seeked on the time of his death repentance from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And to add it, these ahadith, the Rafidis, they say that he was in his death pang, and he, that's why he said all these things. So can you imagine that a person who is suffering the pangs of death, the gargara of death, and he would say such things. So we don't have any right to criticize the companions of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in a wrong way, but surely there are some people who did the wrong things, and they should not be criticized, but that should be seen as a method to take guidance and to be on the right path. So my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, this is a very important hadith, and I know that I just read the hadith, I did not explain it in the way it should have been done, which might be because of my personality or because of my tongue, which is not that eloquent, my mentality, which is not that good. Whatever I said, just go through it and seek repentance from Allah and seek hidayah from Allah, because it is only Him from which you get hidayah, and it is from only by the His grace we will enter the our final goal, that is the paradise. Wallahu alam. Jazakumullah khair. Subhanak Allahumma wa bihamdika nashhadu an la ilaha illa nastaghfiruka wa atubu ilaik wa ma alaina illa al-balaghul mubin. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu.